So thank you very much to our German astronaut, Reinhold.
Thanks, Andreas. Thanks to the whole org team for putting this together. And thanks to you all coming on that rather dull Cologne morning. Well, there was better times, and I hope that the weather will come up to your mood and your interest during the weekend. Yeah, space up. I think I choose something that would interest you all, which has to do with the profession of astronauts, but astronauts rely on a large team on the ground, so this is only the visible part of the work that has been done by lots of people. And astronauts try to do their best in order to perform in space according to the expectations of all these people. So gravity, no thanks. My working place flies in space. And in 45 minutes, I hope I succeed in getting some of the ideas through. So first obstacle is the launch of the presentation. Ah, okay. Now it comes. Yep. Fine. So, short history of spaceflight, and then we jump right into today. So, first satellite ever, well, you're acquainted with that, is only a couple of 60 or so years ago. And very fast on, immediately, at least in Russia and America, the idea was there to send humans. I mean, this is not an obvious thought. You can exploit the unmanned or uncrewed or unhuman spaceflight sector and do lots of things, but there was always the wish to send humans as well, as explorers, as people who can put a situation together and get out of a non-planned event. So 1961, we are looking back on that. We have been to the moon. We is my generation, at least. And I was fascinated by that, I can tell you, as a little boy sitting up late in the night, see these wishy-washy black and white things. And well, the cinema is always in your head. It's not that you saw all the details. And this is today. It's not only 2014, but it's still flying, I can assure you, space station. Europeans have always played a part in, a very important part in going out, exploring the world, setting sails to new continents, to new oceans. And that is also what the European Astronaut Corps, at least, wants to participate in and wants to drive forward. So let's see how we fare. In the 1960s, there was not much in terms of future-oriented literature, or future-oriented whatever sci-fi things in Germany. So, but the one thing we had the very first and best ever science fiction series, which was called Raumpatrouille Orion. And the main thing about it that I want to point out, it was international. I mean, the crew was completely international. There was an American commander. No, I can't point that out. On the screens, there was an American commander chasing after a Russian, very attractive Russian security officer, Tamara Yagolovsk. There was a Mongolian guy, Artan Shubashi, who was on the engines of the spaceship, and a French girl was looking for any objects nearing. So this was a really international thing, despite some funny clothing and hairdo. I think that was pointing to a good future of spaceflight. Well, we have seen that one at some time during your studies, during your takes with spaceflight. It's Stanley Kubrick. And if you see this, you immediately hear music playing in your ear, the Blue Danube, the spaceship approaching the huge space station. It's all in. It's artificial gravity by rotating the space station. It's fancy spacesuits. It's well-lit corridors. It's an after-work lounge where you can sit down and sip a drink in an international environment and ask what's happening on the moon, and no one gives you an answer because this is top secret and all this. So we have elements of actually everything that we see today, and we will see later how that came along in reality. I took a detour, let's say, before joining space flight, I became a radio astronomer with a love to high places. As you can see, this is the Gornergrad Observatory, high up, 10,000 feet in the Swiss mountains. And I spent a lot of time there when the tourists were gone. It was marvelous. We opened the telescope dome. We had a clear view of the galactic center with our radio telescope. And quite opposite was the Matterhorn. So something, well, you would say, if this goes on like this, it's a funny life. Well, it went on. I had the opportunity to work with the Sophia Airborne Observatory, even fly on the predecessor of this telescope in the stratosphere with the Kuiper Airborne aircraft. And so, what was next? Well, next is space. I wanted to go to space, and when I had the opportunity to apply for a job in the German astronaut team back in '86, I didn't hesitate, despite the fact that this was the year that Challenger exploded. And I was not aware where I would be going, whether it would be rather the American column of spaceflight, or we were not much aware of the Russian column that only came in the 90s. At least it was a fascinating selection process, and I ended up as a finalist and later in the astronaut corps. And that brought me to the Mir space station. Not many of us at that time knew a lot about the Mir space station. Only in 1990, Russia opened up for truly also Western international cooperation. Before that, a couple of people had been on board of Mir station as guests in the Intercosmos program. But now we had the chance to see what marvel in the sky was taking shape there. I mean, the first element launched in 1986 as the base block, and then all the elements were added Lego-like, I would say, by putting a spacecraft into space, providing it with a docking node, and sticking it to the already existing complex. And by, the Mir space station came to a size of 150 tons of mass, 6 modules joined together. It was fairly capable of supporting science, supporting research. It was meant also to do the oceanographic and terrestrial observation of Russian territory. So it had all the elements that you would expect of a space station. It was still Russian heritage, and it heavily depended on the Russian situation. That is what brought us up there, because they were strapped of cash at that time, and they were selling time on board of the space station to these purposes. And that is the composition of the crew I flew in. I flew up with 2 Russians on a Soyuz in 10th of February 1997, and we joined another team up there who had already spent some time on board of the Mir space station, Valery Korsun, Sasha Kaleri, and Jerry Lininger. So NASA was also taking the opportunity to get a first-hand experience on how to run a space station and what it meant to be longer in space than just the period that the shuttle could spend in space, 10 days, 14 days, that was the usual shuttle flight at that times. And Jerry spent a couple of months, like about 8 or 9 of his colleagues who had seen some action in space. Okay, it was a flight dedicated for science, but you never know, things happen in space, and the Mir space station was at that time already beyond its best guaranteed life, so some things happened, like our fire that we had on board on a Sunday night. We had to lit another oxygen candle. Mir was meant for 3 persons, in a sustainable way of doing life support, but we were 6, so we had to had additional oxygen, and one of the candles burst into flames. We had smoke, we had everything that you didn't want to have on such a close environment, like molted metal particles floating to the outer wall of the space station. We finally we got hold of this situation with the board means that we use fire extinguishers. You see us wearing gas masks for 2.5 hours in the middle of the night. Forget about communication. Mir space station only had the way had a chance to communicate once it was over Russian territory or Soviet or Russian territory, how you would call it. That was 6 out of the 16 daily orbits, and we were just on the other side of the orbit, so we could not communicate what was happening until the early morning, when the situation had already cleared up enough so that we could go on. That was not my fault, if you want to ask. I mean, this was the same year, 1997, and one of the Progress spacecraft got out of control, bumped into the most modern and most capable module of the Mir space station, the Spectrum module. It went into depressurization. It was just by the really courageous action of the crew that they could shut off this module from the rest of the station, and finally in the repairs they could in the end recover at least the electricity, but not the function of the module. It remained without air until the end of the life of Mir station. Well, that kind of broke a backbone. Talking of bones, you know this cut, this marvelous cut in the Stanley Kubrick 2001, where this ape is throwing up the first tool humans ever invented, which is a bone, and it's thrown up into space and it turns into a spaceship. So Mir space station turned into something else, which is with the help of the shuttle and the Soyuz, the International Space Station. I mean, there's a clear heritage for leading from Mir space station into the ISS. These were the means with which we accomplished the International Space Station, and that another sign of international cooperation was to the rescue of International Space Station and its program at all times, that we could rely on different vehicles, different also technical cultures and different means to get into space. Don't underestimate what Space Shuttle did for Space Station. I mean, in the end, there was a lot of discussion of going on with Space Shuttle, but it had fulfilled its main task, which was to finish Space Station building. And the Soyuz, as dumb as it looks like in the moment, compared to flashy new designs and flashy new techniques, I mean, it's meant to do exactly that. It's meant to bring up three people in a safe manner to an object that is already in space, dock and rendezvous with this object, and bring them safely down in case something goes wrong or at the end of the mission. And that is why it never changed. I mean, as long as it's doing this task, who cares about crew comfort? Who cares about sitting in a lounge chair and having a drink? I mean, it's space, and it's not very friendly to you, and you better have something sturdy, something reliable around you. That's the way you need to see Soyuz. The core of the space station, for those of you that probably have not followed it so intensely shortly, a report was an American module, the one to the right up there, which was called Node 1 or Unity, and another American module, no, a Russian-built module that was then in the end sped up by payments from the US, and some of the storage space and some of the functions of this module still belong to NASA and can be used by NASA, which was the FGB, the functional cargo block that the Russians provided. And here you see the difference between how the Russians build a space station and how the rest of the Western world wanted to go along. I mean, the FGB on the left-hand side is a space vehicle. It has avionics, it has an energy providing system, it has engines, it has... So it's a self-standing space vehicle, whereas the node and all the labs and stuff won't survive a day in space without the help of some powering agent like the shuttle or the robot arm or whatever. So whenever you moved one of these vehicles in the direction of space station, there was a thermal clock ticking and you had to do it within a couple of hours. Otherwise, you would have lost part of the functionality of these highly sophisticated models. It's a different philosophy. It fit well together, and that's how it looked in the end. So, but keep in mind, it's different. It's a different approach. Space station grew and grew, and also European astronauts could help to do a couple of these daring rebuildings of the space station. Christoph Vogel sang he helped to carry one of the large solar array units from one side to the other, thereby still also repairing broken solar panels. So interesting things happened, but it all depended on a flow of vehicles up to the space station. And 2003, with the Columbia accident, we lost one of the main important vehicles, the space shuttle. It was down for repairs. It was a time where we could not fly to space station in the regular and foreseen fashion. We went down from 3 to 2 crew members on board of space station just to be able to cope with logistics in a reduced way. And only in 2006, when Thomas Reiter launched, Thomas, our German ESA colleague, launched to the space station, the crew replenished from 2 to 3. And ever after, then it became even 6 people in the long run. We in Germany, in Europe, were interested to provide, continue with our way of doing science in space. So consequently, we provided a laboratory to the International Space Station, the Columbus Laboratory. It rested for a long time in the Kennedy hangar. If you have been a guest at Kennedy Space Center, you could see the Bremen sign and the ESA sign and everything in the integration hall. And here you see Leopold Eliard from France, an ESA astronaut, and Leo and Hans Schlegel preparing for the delivery flight of Columbus, which was just fully dubbed 1E, first European flight. And it happened in 2008, a little bit late, but not too late, to find the space station in good shape in order to accommodate the Columbus module. That is the moment where Leo told us, I hear metal scratching, Columbus is joining the International Space Station. So it's at the starboard port, where you see it there, of the Unity, of the Node 2 module, Harmony. And it ever after rested there. Also, Columbus is not able to sustain itself without the help of the space station. So it's not a spaceship in the very narrow sense of it. It's an addition to the International Space Station, heavily depending in life support, in power, in everything from what is done on the International Space Station. But space station has grown. You see this amazing truss with lots of elements providing cooling, providing solar power, providing communication. So that is really impressive. 80 by 110 meters of football field, and I mean a European football field, with that above you, and you can see it once the fog clears. You can see it as a bright dot crossing the sky from west to east. So that is an amazing achievement. Science fiction has come through. We have the space station, though, without music, I have to say. And we can fly to it with different vehicles. We can live long stretches of time on the space station. And the working place in space has really become a reality. I'm still living to see that. That is a very nice thing. What we see is also that we need the human interaction with this huge complex in order to solve very special questions, in order to overview the and overlook the complex activities that are in there. It's the only space vehicle that answers, by the way. I always discuss when I discuss with space controllers who do unmanned or satellites, and they say, yeah, I dumped my commands and the satellite dumps its data, and here it answers. And most of you here in the ESC staff who sit on console, you can say you can tell a story about how complicated sometimes it is if the spacecraft complains or has extra wishes instead of just taking commands. Hans Schlegel had the opportunity to go out on EVA during this 1E mission. I'm pretty sure they I tried to get my DNA up on Columbus. I honestly tried last time. I had the chance to see it in the clean room. I took off my glove, now I can admit, and made a fingerprint on the outer shell, but those guys washed it down, I'm pretty sure, before launching it. So I didn't ask Hans whether he see my fingerprint. But this is amazing job. I mean, taking the last finishing modes of Columbus. And this is how, if you happen to be in the way of space station, it is flying with 28,000 kilometers per hour towards you, Columbus and the Japanese module to the right. And you see the flight of space vehicles, attached progress, Soyuz, everything that you need in order to do make space flight running, space station running. And this is the most busy picture that we will ever have of a space station. The space shuttle docked at one end, so Paolo Nespoli, our Italian colleague, had the privilege to detach with the Soyuz from the space station and do this series of videographing and photographing of the International Space Station with the space shuttle attached. And on the other end, you see the ATV, the European Transport Vehicle. Part of it is displayed here and at other places in this control center. This was another addition of Europe to the International Space Station. It was partly because we had to pay our dues for running the space station, and we didn't want to send money to the Lehman Bank, who later on got bankrupt. So what do? We barter, which means that we have European industry delivering things that are of interest for the whole space space station community, and compensate by these deliveries, compensate for the common operation cost, but the money goes into European industry instead of to some bank account. And this is the idea of the ATV. It did a marvelous job. And it's still the people that make up the work on board of the International Space Station. As you can see, this crowd of people after finishing with the Columbus work really made a what do you call that? Flash mob inside the space station. And you also see that nothing is like in training. If you come to visit our space station, our Columbus model in there, you will see neatly packed, and all the trainers have looked that there are no cables to trip over, or some things left that don't belong to the training unit that you want to perform in this morning. And it's all very lively inside there. So this is one of the less crowded pictures, but I can tell you the current status of space station, only the real crew knows who is up on space. And so we will shortly see the launch of another crew, and it will take them a week or so to get acquainted alone for the differences between what they have seen in the training unit and what they automatically will later on do on board of the International Space Station. A new space station, new astronaut, that's only a consequence, I think, and it's no wonder that, or it's no marvel, that the European Astronaut Corps, the average age of the European Astronaut Corps every year is increased by 1 year. So we have to do something, and we selected 6 new astronauts from different European countries back in 2009. Probably a couple of you were part of the process to apply. And these 6 were the lucky ones, and 3 of them already had have the privilege to be in orbit or to have flown in orbit, and 3 others will come. So I take it from left to right. Samantha is up there still for a couple of months now. She will come back in May, doing good work, and her interest in nutrition and other subjects is also followed on the ground. Luca down there, he made one of the scariest EVA that the history of spaceflight has seen. His helmet started to fill with water, and until now it's not clear, not really clear, I mean, how to prevent this from happening again. But he reacted very, very professionally, very coolly, telling the story. And at the slightest suspicion of that something is going wrong, he took the right way back into the airlock, and so he was in a safe mode. Up above him is Thomas Pesquet. He will fly in 2017, French astronaut in the European Astronaut Corps. And he will see also a 6 months mission. And down again, it's Andreas Morgensen. He's bound for a flight, a very attractive flight, because he has a British singer beside him, to the space station. It's not only the long-term mission that make the difference. It's also doing science, for example, in 10 days, 14 days, like in my flight. My flight was 3 weeks. And bring it down, that is very interesting, and Andreas has the chance to do that in September. Alexander Gerst above him, he had been flying in May till November 2014. I will tell a little bit more about his flight soon. And then Tim Peake from Great Britain, who is coming up, I think, in the end of this year, in order to stay 6 months on board a space station. So it's not only six capable people, but it's also challenging flights that we can provide them with. And after 2017, we have to see how things goes. Well, the main contribution, as I said, is the Columbus module, cutaway view here. But also with the partnership, you have to provide an end-to-end capability to run whatever you send up into space. And this is a real distinction. It's not the delivering and forgetting, it's operations. Operations is a longer lasting part than development and delivery of a module. And I've been in this control center working to build it up and educate the teams for 6 years until 2011. That was my working place, the Columbus Control Center. And as we speak, there are people sitting in the control room of the Columbus Control Center interfacing with Houston, interfacing with Japan, interfacing with Russia, in order to run space station in a coordinated and consolidated fashion. So this is a really attractive job. We have a couple of hundred operators going through the training and leaving after some time and taking up very interesting job. But contrary to most of their fellow kids in university, they had a real responsibility. It might be in the night shift that something happens where you have to make the 1 million euro decision whether to switch on something or not switch it off or whatever. And this can be on you, on your shoulders, and with a glance over to the experienced flight director, you would make sure that yes, your judgment, your reasoning is well taken. So I see a lot of very interesting supporting functions, especially in these control centers or in the training field or whatever, that makes space flight challenging, not only for the astronaut, but also for those that prepare the flight and go on. This is the way they operate on board. Probably a couple of you are familiar with this onboard plan. It's called OSTPV, onboard short-term plan, and this is the view of it. So on the left-hand column, you see all the crew members. I took the most crowded situation that I couldn't get, with two Soyuz up and the spaceflight participants plus a crew in orbit. And for everyone, and Andrea just talked about the DPC, the day starts with the DPC, daily planning conference. That is a must for all, except for the spaceflight participants who can sleep through. And then we go into every day's work in a almost 10-minute, 5-minute roster of following activities. And if you click on all these bars, you will have the procedure ready to follow. And this is the main instrument with which the control center assure that they are on a synergetic and harmonious path, and the crew on board. And in the evening, they will report back what has been done, what still remains to be done. So these things are all captured on the OSTPV, and most of the energy to prepare the day goes into getting up a conflict-free OSTPV. Alex Gerst, ESA astronaut of German nationality, flew a mission he called Blue Dot. You see the hands taking care of Earth. You see space station and all the symbolics, Mars and indicated by a red star and other future targets. So he was really inspired by something that Carl Sagan had coined. The word, the pale blue dot, comes from this photograph of Voyager looking back into the solar system, on the brink of the solar system, 1990. Voyager had, besides cosmic dust and everything, had a little point you see between the bars, a little bluish haze, and this is the Earth. This is the Earth seen from this perspective. I mean, it's kind of second Copernican revolution that we are just a pale blue dot, even from the perspective of the outskirts of our solar system, even less so from another star or from interplanetary space. And everything that I say, everything that you do, everything that your parents and grandchildren will do happens on this pale blue dot, and so he was quite impressed on this and chose it as the name of his mission. Yeah, and truly so, because 70% of the Earth is looking like this. It's the blue haze of the atmosphere up to 80 kilometers. It's the clouds. It's the oceans. Whenever I happened to look out of the window, I would see either the night side of the Earth, where it's hard to distinguish what's below, or an ocean. And you had to really target the moments you were crossing some land, which was also fascinating, I can tell you. And Alex illustrated the pale blue dot by this. He became fairly acquainted, quickly acquainted with the space station in good shape, and did a marvelous mission, fulfilling a lot of tasks on board of the space station together with his crew. And you see them in the moment Alex has to leave, actually. And I was in Russia this week, and I met Zerova and the others, and even they have by now also left, so the whole crew is back, safely back on Earth, and they were in very good shape. And I can say that the flow of crews to the International Space Station, the way they are prepared by this center, by other centers, the way they keep shape in space has very much improved over the times that I lived through, or even the early times of space station. If you've seen Alex arriving here at the Cologne airport only 12 hours after he landed in the steppes of Kazakhstan, waving, smiling, upright, moving his head, which I would have avoided at that time after my landing. I mean, you can see that we make huge progress to adapt also the human body to living and working in space. Even at took the time to do this famous selfie. I mean, there are a lot of famous selfies, but this is quite unique, overlooking the Earth and photographing himself doing his EVA, which gives me the chance to make you aware that we are, I came in from Moscow having celebrated 50 years of EVA with Leonov, 1965, 18th of March 1965, doing the very first EVA, 12 minutes. He had a hard time to come back into his spaceship, and it took him longer to report on all these events that I have been through about this than actually it happened. But he made it back into the airlock and with some problems. And he was followed by Ed White shortly after. But his is the first in space of having walked in space. You see the Chinese way of walking into space, also marvelous development that they demonstrated in flights. I mean, I always have envy if I see the picture like the one on the left down, where you're on the tip of the 80 meter long robot arm, and you're the last human being between Earth and Moon. This must have been a great feeling. And Hans Schlegel also enjoying his EVA in the American spacesuit. So accolade and honors to all the spacewalkers. Over 730 spacewalks have been performed since the beginning of spaceflight. The research centered about experiments in a lot of interesting fields of space research. You see the numbers for Alex. I want to point out also education, where you say, okay, education, yes. But it's the kind of thing that coins the next generation or attracts the next generation to also take up probably technology and professions of that kind, because you can demonstrate nice things in space that are very unusual on Earth. He was experimenting with soap bubbles, he was showing Newton's principles, he was all kind of demonstrations that were made up for him, or where he improvised in space. And this is also a message that you can send down, besides the serious science, for sure, that you do from space. If you see those different scientific subjects, well, human research, what was the greatest marvel for me when I thought about my spaceflight is that I was thrown into a completely different environment from what evolution had built my body according to. So I still I could live without artificial dialysis, without having some unhealthy pressure in my brain, because the heart would pump as it would on Earth. The food was going where it was always going on Earth, and it was coming out where it was coming out on Earth. Nothing in your body depends on gravity, really. Nothing depends on gravity. We have to support some of the functions of the body, like you see muscular loss, you see bone loss, you see some irritation of the heart on the long run, just like patients who spend long time in motionless in bed will suffer. But it's nothing serious in the first instances. You are thrown into weightlessness that catastrophically fails. And this is a marvel. I mean, we can tap on some sources of our body that we probably still don't know by going into space, being exposed to this environment and looking deeply whether we really understand medical science and the medical paths in our body. And that is all through the human research, this is all through biology, that we try to exploit the International Space Station to the best in order to look into whether the models we have built under gravity conditions are still holding true if we take away gravity and try to look into the systems. The plants will behave differently, small tissue specimen have been flown in biological facilities like the BioLab, and just as I speak, Samantha is busy doing the triple looks experiment, which looks into immunological questions. The immune system is stimulated differently, weaker than on Earth, and we have to see why that is happening. I mean, what does a single cell of phagocytic cell has to do with gravity? I mean, it could not care less, but something happens there that we don't understand why the immune reaction changes. Look at fluid physics. I mean, I don't need to say that fluids behave most erratically in space. They do large blobs, they float directly into the electronics, so you better take care not to have a large collection of fluids floating around. But it's also, they are reduced on their surface tensions. It's not the drop that you see anymore, it's a sphere. And this makes all kinds of effects, going to foams, emulsions, and colloids. The mixture of these elements is much more homogeneous than you could do them on Earth. Soap bubbles survive because they are not drained out to the bottom by flowing water. And there are all sorts of interesting physical effects that you can really watch slowly and measure slowly in space. The subject of material science always was to, and is, to avoid sedimentation, which means that the components of a melted alloy are separating just because of gravity, and you keep them together, you do a very homogeneous mixture. There have been some plasma research facilities on board, which were able to introduce a stable crystal lattice almost in plasma seeded with little dust particles. All this, is very interesting. I have slides and slides and slides, but no time to go through, so let's just skip this part. And let's have one experiment as an example. Lots of the human research, or all of the human research, the astronauts are most dedicated to perform, that is for sure. Let me skip. That is the triple looks that Samantha is doing. Just point out one, which is in the end, as always. Come on. I think we have these presentations on the server, so if you're interested in parts of the science, that is what I left it in for. Fundamental physics, very interesting. Did I miss it? It's slow. Seem to have missed it. Okay, let's forget it. The one I wanted to point out is EML, the electromagnetic levitator. Electromagnetic levitator avoids that a sample, an alloy, a melted alloy, has contact with any walls of a surrounding experiment cell by levitating it electromagnetically, and this was difficult to achieve, and now it's running, and we expect a lot of results for an undisturbed physical system, a metal alloy or whatever, being kept in the experiment cell without touching the walls. What is also a new feature of these flights is the contact via social media, and most of you probably have followed Astro Alex, and the way to look over the shoulder of the astronaut in the instance he or she is doing the experiment is quite some achievement. Okay, short word on the logistics of spaceflight. The automated transfer vehicle brought up and automatically docked to the, and automatically docked to the International Space Station with a high precision, provided them with gases, water, and fuel. It also has the capability of lifting space station up as a reboost, and five of them went to the space station and ended up in a fiery ball on the way back to the atmosphere. These are the names. Okay, so also for documentation rather. And this is the nice view of the ATV. We will see more of ATV in the so-called European Service Module, which is the engine compartment that Europe provides to the American Orion vehicle, the deep space vehicle that is doing its first flight, hopefully in 2017, manned space flight, with a European Service Module. These are the two gentlemen waiting for the ATV to dock, and this is the approach of the last ATV. You would not go in without some safety precautions, because there may be floating objects after the launch, the rather shaky launch on the Ariane 5. There are others on the horizon, like the Dragon Cargo, and it can also be turned into a crew vehicle, let's see, to provide transport to the International Space Station. So the story goes on, despite that we don't have the shuttle anymore. There are followers on the way, and also they have the capability to bring down some of the experiment results from the space station. It's something that we have been missing with the shuttle. So shuttle would bring down tons and tons of stuff for further investigation on Earth, but ever since we lost the shuttle, it was not possible anymore. This is a kind of a quiz where you would find the space vehicle. Look in the upper left there. There's the little Cygnus approaching above Lake Constance in southern Germany, and it has to be captured also by the by the robot arm in order to be provided to the space station. Okay, this is space station. What is coming? I can't tell you as much as Meister Yoda says. It's hard to see. We have seen marvelous events in 2014. This is the Rosetta spacecraft approaching the comet 67P Churyumov-Gerasimenko. After all these years, I now know it. And we have seen the Philae landing on the comet. We need to be aware that there are many more of these objects, and probably we have to do it better than in Armageddon in order to save ourselves from these objects. That is an interesting field. I'm pretty sure that spaceflight will get a real boost if now we discover there's an object coming, let's say, within the next period of legislature of our politicians. So if it's in 10 periods, okay, they are out, but the next is always interesting. And so we have to watch out what is around us, and we have to go out, and going out can mean we go to go back to the moon, we go to asteroids. This is in the making, I mean, with the Orion vehicle playing part of it. Whether it's interesting to do that or whether it's creating the same effect on a next generation, a next century of potential spacefarers, that needs to be seen. I find it very interesting to see this pristine material. You can go to the moons of Mars, which also are kind of remains of this pristine origin of our solar system, or you can go to Mars itself, which is quite a task in the future. Okay, I've prepared some views from above, and most of these views are done in another element that was provided by Europe, but on a barter basis given to the US, which is the cupola. You see it hanging right above me here, and cupola provides the first 360 view of the space station surrounding. I never saw Mir space station. I mean, I docked with the space station. That was the first impression I had from space station, a module sticking out inside. You could only glance parts of it, but I never saw the Mir space station in its completeness. And going back from the space station, we were not allowed to circumnavigate it in order to see something. So this is the privilege of the people up on the ISS to be in the cupola and have a good view of the Earth and the space station. And you can do funny things there. You can record space oddity of David Bowie inside the space station. Even the science fiction movies are behind because we were first. This is 2000, or this is 10,000 something, and Andrea Kuipers already is hanging in the very same built custom-made space cupola right now. And the one thing that you can't really capture by camera and video is flying into the aurora. And you see, this is the most amazing moment when your spaceship goes deep down in the south, or deep up in the north, as you wish, into the aurora. By the way, we had aurora this week down to Moscow, so it was amazing. It seems to be a solar activity. And this is the famous time sequence movies that you see now and then. So high definition cameras are able to you have to help Heinz to launch the video. No, there's a video hidden on this one. So to come to an end, I want to put your geography on a test. Where are we flying here? Yeah, the France really love their country. They recognize it from space. That's true. Let's have it again. I tell you where we are. Can we launch it again? Thanks. So we come from the West. You can't avoid. First country you meet crossing the Atlantic is Ireland. So you have Dublin now crossing the middle. And they have London now crossing the middle, and you have Belgium and France and Paris, you see, and you see the boot of Italy even. And then it goes into the less lit plains of Siberia. So this is what you can get if you cut high definition photography in this marvelous fashion that we see. With that, I want to close. No, I have another one of these interesting quotes. Yeah. With that, I want to close and wish you a very successful Space Up with lots of information, lots of friends, lots of good news.
Thank you very, very much, Reinhold. We have a few gifts for you. These Space Up mug and a poster, which I'll take back from you because our delegates will sign it and then I'll put it in your office on Monday. And we have also a special kit for you to build your own custom space station out of Lego. This is not even on the market yet, but we have it custom designed from a master builder. So
it's called Concurrent Design Facility.
Exactly. Yes, you're welcome. All right, so if you'd like to ask any questions to Reinhold, let me know. And he can answer questions before we go to our coffee break. Any questions that you would like to ask our astronaut? Yep. Sebastian, can you take the third mic and take the question from Jim at the back?
You said that you don't want to mention the future too specifically, but of course, working in the ISS ground segment, you can imagine that we're very excited to know a little bit what's going on, and whether it's 2020, 2024, or potentially even some other plans to extend it. So, of course, I don't want to, make this political question to you. I'm sure nobody's listening, but could you give us some creative feels what you think will come up?
Yeah, there are a couple of reasons to run space station. One of the most important in the moment is the international cooperation, I have to say. Science is always following some good other reasoning to go places. It was not because of the science that they went to the moon. It was to show technical capabilities and to demonstrate first in space and stuff. Space station also is not ideal for science, but nevertheless we do science. So there will always be science, but it's not the only reason. I think that the science, the interesting, really interesting science must be supported by other fields of research, like I skipped it, but ACES is one of the examples where I would say it's worth building a space station around. ACES is an atomic clock ensemble in space, which would be another test of Einstein's theory of relativity and maybe lead us to very different other fields in physics. And if we gain the support, if everyone thinks this is a good idea to do that space mission, then we are more successful than pushing our ideas in the public. So we have to wait for the moment that the world community, which is very busy with very naughty things in the moment, I mean cruel things and wars and stuff, but that the world community thinks this is the time to go to Mars, and then it will be an easy one to provide the technology to go to Mars. So you have the public engagement behind you. You are on the winning side, and much more so than convincing people of that you can technically do it and that it makes sense and that it's a logical first step. Space station certainly will be around till 2017 in the fashion we know it. It will be around until 2020 with X modifications in operating it, because this will be part of an ESA ministerial council in 1 or 2 years time to decide. The US at least have already committed to 2024. The Russians are on the way to do that, besides having plans with an alternative space station. Japan and Europe, I can't tell because this is my boss taking this decision. And so I hope that yes, what is important for me is that you have to see the whole end-to-end chain, that you cannot I mean, what is a program worth that sends a spacecraft in 2017, a spacecraft in 2021, in 2025? You lose astronauts, you lose ground crews, you lose engineers that just drift away, not waiting 4 years for the next project to come that you cannot afford. What you need is a sustained, large program, and there is no other way I can imagine than a space station. Not necessarily in low Earth orbit, it may be in a Lagrange orbit or whatever, but the space station is the only regular course. You have teams on the ground, you have astronauts, you have trainers and stuff. So it will, for me, the best mixture would be to have exploration missions once in a while, but also a sustained presence in space via a space station.
All right, one, maximum two more questions before we go to coffee. Olivia, over there.
Thank you. You first showed us a picture about the astronaut class of 2009, and they're very successful in orbit. You also said that you see a space station in future, but also exploration missions. Do you see another astronaut call coming up in the next years?
Yeah, I'm a great advocate for regular astronaut calls, but no one hears me. I mean, six is a crowd, and it was kind of a good work and very very successful work to make them all fly. But you could have made two classes out of it. In order to inspire the ever next generation leaving universities, trying to come into the field. I mean, this was a real success also PR-wise for ESA 2009. We had 8,500 academic young people from all over Europe answering. I mean, this is something you have a hard time to do by a normal way of press releases and stuff. So yes, I very wish for you, the young ones here that still have the decision where to go in their lives, that you will see an astronaut selection. But on the other hand, I understand that if you don't have flights for the potential astronauts, I mean, this is taking them from a potentially brilliant career into a field where they then wait and wait and wait and finally, the real kick is flying at least once into space, and if they don't make it, it would be a shame. So I hope something comes up as soon as we have a firm fixed grip on the other question of what is following space station or whether we go on with space station until 2000X.
Okay, one last question. Daniel at the back.
Hi, so everyone talks about a European flight opportunity with NASA and Orion, and this is obviously a big topic. What about European flight opportunities with the Russians or the Chinese?
First of all, we have to see that the Americans are not NASA anymore only. We can easily buy a flight. I mean, once Dragon provides a regular service to the International Space Station, we could consider of looking at the price list and saying, I want a 10-day mission, 20-day, whatever. So there are new opportunities, and the Russians offer these flights. By chance, we have the opportunity to see a spaceflight participant in September because we have this one-year crew remaining in orbit. The Chinese are another options where it's only too known that ESA also maintains good relations now to the Chinese astronaut world. I would say the training centers talk to each other and other officials. So there are a couple of opportunities, but nothing that you would found a need to recruit new astronauts on in the moment. That is why ESA is hesitant there.
Awesome. All right, we're going to wrap up questions there for now. We have prepared, Georg has prepared coffee and some snacks for you guys. So please refresh. Remember, the toilets, if you do need them, are just behind the back, behind the Lego and Sam's poster. They are also in the coffee area. Please do label your stuff or put it inside your bag so you can distinguish your bag from the other 100 bags. And just as For your awareness, you are allowed here to take photos of absolutely everything. So go nuts, there's no restrictions. You're allowed to take photos of whatever you like, tweet everything. Just don't touch the Soyuz module that's behind the barrier for a good reason. Aside from that, yeah, please do take photos of everything. Remember, the hashtag is SpaceUpCGN, so use that in all of your tweets and posts when you're doing that. And if you are presenting in the main foyer, see us for a media form. There. When you are having coffee, please don't take any food or drinks outside the coffee area except for water. You'll see next to the astronaut training pool where everything is for that. And also, for people that are planning future space ups, Alex over here designed all of our space up logos and mini and main logos for the site. So see her for ideas for your future space ups. And thank you again very, very much, Ryan Holt. He won't say it, but he is a huge part of what's behind. And Sebastian?
What? Is it on? Yeah. Just one thing. If you haven't signed up for the dinner tonight and you still want to, just a reminder, like, see me now during this break and we can sort it out. I have the menus here, so just... see me if you want to join tonight.
All right. Please enjoy coffee, and it'll be a bit shorter than planned, so please be back here about 11 o'clock.